We are proud of it. And again, welcome, and any other guest we're missing, please identify yourself. We always want to welcome you. My better part of my life is here. My wife Margie's here in the second row, and so she's auditing me and make sure that I stay in a straight line. And I was hoping that this one would walk in just in time. We're not going to embarrass you, Rip Finley. But Rob, I'm going to let you introduce Rip, your son.
This is my number one conservationist golfer. Better at everything than me, he'll tell you, except making a living. He's still working that part out. But happy that he made it down here, though. Looking forward to a fun day. He spent a whole week working on duck blinds and duck holes and, you know, chasing snakes and swatting mosquitoes. And when you're from Mountain Home, Arkansas, it takes a lot to learn how to catch up to that. So glad he's here.
Yeah, Rip, we are glad to see you this morning. Proud of obviously having your dad on here. But you and your dad have been another good example of legacy in front of us. Rip's been around a long time. I remember Deke Whitbeck, he and Rob, his dad, on one of the first foundation videos that got promoted youth in the outdoors and so forth. So welcome. All right, so we'll get started, and I'll call the meeting to order. And in order of business, if you'll rise with me and join me, and we're welcoming Chaplain Tony Davis. And Tony's going to lead us in our invocation, and then again, right behind that, we'll do the Pledge of Allegiance. But I just say this, all of us know Tony prays for this agency and our people more than just on a commission Thursday morning. And he's had a few more titles than just chaplain for this commission. So Tony, it's terrific seeing you and having you here. So please lead us in prayer.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Let's pray. Dear gracious and heavenly Father, Lord, we just come today and we just thank you, and we just ask that you just pour your blessings out upon us, Lord. Lord, I ask that you bless this commission, that you give them wisdom and guidance as they make decisions about how to be good stewards of your great and glorious creation. Lord, I also ask that you be with our staff, that you give them the courage and strength and also the discernment to also be the on-the-ground people that put those decisions into motion. Lord, if there's any staff members that have, or family members that are ill or sick or anxious, Lord, I ask that you send your glorious comforter, your healer, your Holy Spirit to comfort them and to heal them and guide them as well. Lord, I ask that you be with all those in authority, specifically our mayor, our governor, and our president, that you surround them with wise counsel and give them discerning hearts to do what is right in your eyes. And Lord, I also ask that you be with all those that are serving here at home and overseas, but especially our wildlife officers. Please protect them and guide them and bring them home safely to their families. We ask all this in your name, for yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right. Again, thank you, Tony. And first item on the agenda will be the approval of today's agenda. So I'll ask for a motion approving the agenda.
Move to approve.
Second.
All right. All in favor?
Aye. Aye. Aye.
All right. None opposed. Next will be the approval of the commission meeting notes from our June 17th meeting. And to see if there's any additions, corrections, or deletions there. If not, look for a motion.
Move to approval.
Second. All right. Second. All in favor?
Aye.
You know, I think all of us, and it's a real honor to kind of pause here, serving as a commissioner, it is an honor. Everyone that's ever been through here, sat at these seats, knows and understands it. And it hurts every time, if it's a former commissioner or anything, when we lose one. And we lost another great one in Bill Ackerman here, unfortunately, this year. And the staff joined, gosh, I don't remember, there's quite a few commissioners. I had a chance to be there. Anne-Marie, I know you came up. Austin, Andrew Parker, Chairman Parker, was at the memorial service, some other staff as well. So we had a chance to attend that, but the staff here has produced a appropriate tribute video. And I'm sure, hopefully, Bootsy Ackerman is watching this morning as well. If there's ever been a good champion when they left to see the commissioner agency in Arkansas, it was certainly Bill Ackerman. So we'll play that and let you enjoy in his honor.
Tenure on the Arkansas Game and Fish Commission was brief, but his impact on the natural state's fish and wildlife resources has been lasting. Ackerman, who served on the Game and Fish Commission from 2001 to 2003, died June 15th at his home in Fayetteville. A native of Roswell, New Mexico, Bill moved to Northwest Arkansas in 1992 and made it his home, attracted by the natural state's rich natural bounty. Few would argue that his passion was trout. Throughout his life, Bill gave his time to serve his community and state through public service. But nowhere is Bill's lasting influence seen more than in Arkansas trout management. He worked tirelessly during his time on the commission to shine a light on trout regulations and establish special regulations areas dedicated to the pursuit of big trout and the protection of spawning sites. Arkansas's North Fork River, the 4.5-mile tailwater below Norfolk Dam, has been called, mile for mile, one of the best trout fisheries in the world, and it held a special place in Bill's heart. He fished it often with light tackle and zig jigs, always maintaining a spotless boat. No small feat when you're catching them as well as Bill usually did. It's fitting that another of Bill's lasting legacies is the North Fork's Bill Ackerman River Ridge Public Access, a gateway to world-class trout fishing.
Wildman Wilson, I know you probably spent many a time with Bill Ackerman. In fact, we heard some of that Anne-Marie at his funeral or memorial service as well. And Ben Batten, I know you know how much his impact really mattered. When it came to fishing, he's one of those that was either going, coming, or thinking about it. And we heard that well expressed. So thank you, staff, for that appropriate tribute. Okay, next order of business, we have a presentation. And let's see, I think we have Brad Carner that will give us a update on the GTR efforts.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good morning, everyone. We got off into a little bit of this discussion yesterday during our committee meetings, and I guess I want to kind of today in this morning's presentation that this topic and our efforts over the past 7+ years are too much to try to cover at one time. We heard clearly yesterday the commission's desire to hear some more detailed information about plans for individual WMAs as we move forward with infrastructure designs and changes and forest management plans. And Luke Naylor, our waterfowl coordinator, and Rob Willie will be back before the commission in August to give that much more detailed presentation with specific emphasis on areas like Earl Buss Bio de Vue and Henry Gray Hurricane Lake, where we are further along in really reaching that point that we are very close to beginning construction on the ground with our renovation, hopefully later this summer. My point today in my presentation is to cover some of the background, set the stage for next month's presentation. It's easy with an issue as large and complex as this one, it's easy to lose track of actually the great progress and momentum that we have made in the past few years. And so I think it's a good time, particularly as we have new commissioners and a new director, and just to kind of revisit some of that and provide some updates. So with that, this current effort really initiated in earnest in 2014. Our Green Tree Reservoirs, to set the stage, you know, we have 16 different WMAs across the state that have some 42 different GTR impoundments, Green Tree Reservoirs, that were designed to hold water. The infrastructure that's in place was designed to hold water in flooded or in bottomland hardwood forest during the wintering migration period for waterfowl habitat and waterfowl hunting opportunity. We have over 50,000 acres of commission-owned GTRs across the state. on-the-ground managers for a number of years have begun to see changes occurring in our forest and growing forest health concerns. Some of the earliest areas where we began to experience some major declines were at Dave Donaldson, Black River WMA, and on some smaller, less known areas such as Gallow Creek WMA in Pope County. But beginning in 2014, we realized that we had to take an overall look at the entirety of our GTR acreage. And so that started with a forest health assessment at that time. We all know that the state is largely private lands, 90%. But if you look in the Mississippi Alluvial Valley, the public lands that are there represent a third of the remaining bottom and hardwood forest in that area. So they are significant. And not only to waterfowl, we talk a lot about waterfowl and particularly mallards and the importance of those to the state, but there are other species of greatest conservation need that are directly associated with those large blocks of bottom and hardwood forest. And you see photos there of just three examples, Prothonotary warbler, cerulean warbler, and then the swallowtail kite. So they are significant and they must be, they must be of the utmost importance to us in trying to sustain those. We know from a mallard perspective, Arkansas leads the nation every year, and it is not even close in mallard harvest. I mean, there's not even a close second. So the mallard is the primary reason for the long, rich waterfowl hunting heritage in the state, the economic benefits that we derive from that. In looking at bottom and hardwood forest habitats, species composition matters to mallards. And in particular, as we move forward with our discussions, we are most concerned with red oak species, predominantly willow oak and nuttall oak, that have acorns that are small enough that mallards are able to utilize. And the other white oak, which is the example there, or overcup oak, is a white oak species that is more water tolerant, much less desirable, and simply, for the most part, not usable by mallards. So our concerns that began to develop were that these decades and decades of the same water management with an early fall closing of water control structures holding throughout the season, and then the stresses of being able to get water off once trees began to green out in the spring and summer, that was having a significant impact on forest composition. We were shifting to more water-tolerant species, overcup oak, maple, and even green ash, and then on down to willow and buttonbush, and that we had major forest health concerns particularly in our red oak forest. And so, as we've had on the ground tours with commissioners and directorate and local officials and state legislators and even congressional representatives over these past really 3 to 4 years, we've had over a dozen of these tours. And the things that our staff point out, and that what as you point them out to even the public, they recognize now what is starting to happen. And so you see trees, such in the illustration there, where you see some of the upper branches that are starting to die back. The bases of the trees are starting to swell. Bark is starting to crack. And that's indicators of what's happening below the soil, below the surface of the soil there, with roots dying back, and then you see wind-thrown trees in the background. So that 2014 picture that we took, that snapshot of collecting data across all 50,000 acres that summer and early fall, it took us until 2016 to be able to summarize and analyze and really look at all of that data. This chart, and through that process, looking at those stress indicators, we ranked classified trees into six categories. The green bars indicating healthy trees, then progressing in degraded health across the scale, with the black bars being dead, red being near death. And so that graph is for all of the nut-all, overcup, and willow oak trees across all 50,000 acres. So you'll see quickly in nut-all and willow oak, that 2014 data indicated that between 40 to 42% of those two desirable species were in heavy advanced stages of stress, near death or dead. And if you look on the right-hand side, the overcup oak, as you would expect, being more tolerant, was relatively more healthy, but still showing 20% or more in the heavy stages of stress, and then really less than 30% that were healthy. And that's across all 50,000 acres. So we came to the commission at that time in 2016, and we said we have major concerns. We need to begin to communicate this. We need to begin to reconsider how we're managing, and major changes are needed. In particular, at that time, the Hurricane Lake, particularly South GTR, stood out. If you look here, this is all trees, all species of trees within the Hurricane Lake South GTR, and you see that 42% at that time of all trees had heavy damage, near death or dead. And I will say that you fast forward today and all of those 42% are now dead, and everything has simply shifted to the right. So at that time, in our conversations with the commission, we secured a long-term commitment to a sustainable GTR management approach, and working to communicate that, because that meant significant changes to when we closed water control structures and what our forest management plans were moving forward. And we began to communicate that clearly and openly to the public and to our staff and legislative representatives. That particular year, we delayed the closing of Hurricane Lake water control structures until November the 15th, and that's significant. I'll get to that in a second. Following that, we began work on a communication piece that our communications staff did a phenomenal job working with Luke Naylor and some of our other staff. You all have seen this document, but this 10-page document summarizes the need, the value of that resource, the changes that are needed, and that document was mailed to every resident that had bought a state waterfowl stamp in the previous 3 years, and every non-resident that had purchased a WMA waterfowl permit. So that amounted to 95,000 households that we direct mailed this document to begin that education process and that messaging. The public meetings began in 2016, first at Searcy, to talk about the things that we were encountering at Hurricane Lake, and then we had five public meetings in 2017 to start that larger conversation about the other areas across the state. And I will say that the plan is, and work is underway, to develop a 2.0 version of this. That target is that it would go out something that we realize there is value in continuing to communicate that message about what has been done, what remains to be done, and some of the successes that we've seen. I mentioned the water WMAs had plans for when we would operate our water control structures, and every one of those had dates in them that we would close water control structures, ranging from October 1st at Hurricane Lake WMA to October 15th at most others. And we realized and with the forest health issues that we had, that that was far, far too early. And so for the 2017-18 season, we made the decision with the commission's support to delay that to November 15th. There are three WMAs in extreme South Arkansas that it's December the 1st, and that's Cutoff Creek, Seven Devils, and Bodark WMAs. But that was a major change. But all in all, I would say has been received fairly well by our waterfowl hunters. There were some grumblings initially, but as individuals and the message has continued to be pushed out, I truly believe there is growing support and a recognition of the need for these changes. So we started the process for individual evaluations on the ground, WMA by WMA, GTR impoundment by GTR impoundment. The first three that you see that were conducted in 2017 were at Bayou de Vue, Hurricane Lake, and Big Lake. And you'll note that I said next month's meeting will have detailed information about the plans, the specific infrastructure plans, forest management plans, at Bayou de Vue and Hurricane Lake. So we're just now getting to that stage, and that's the reason that we're furthest along with those, is that those are the areas that we started with in 2017. Also going on at that same time, we knew that a huge component of this is that we had to have detailed MP and elevations throughout and across our entire GTR ownership that would guide our planning and infrastructure design moving forward. And so that was a two-year-long process with a tremendous amount of help from our GIS staff to partner with USGS to collect that data as part of a much bigger project. So we in 2016-17, probably into 2018, we were able to collect and pay for that elevational data across all of our GTRs. Meanwhile, and as we began those individual WMA evaluations, these photos, and you probably can't see the date stamp at the top, but that's July the 12th of 2017. That has become the norm for what we're experiencing summer after summer after summer on many of our WMAs. And our approach to our infrastructure changes as we move forward. I mentioned earlier that all of our current infrastructure was designed and constructed with the primary intent of how do we hold water during the winter months. It is grossly undersized, oftentimes in the wrong location, and we now must shift that focus to how do we have infrastructure in place that allows us to, as close as possible, emulate natural hydrology and allow the maximum amount of flow through these areas, particularly during the summer months. A big part of this has included, we quickly recognized the need for more local scale hydrology information on our WMAs. The watersheds around our areas has changed dramatically since this infrastructure has been put in place. And so we quickly began a partnership with USGS to install gauges across some of our larger WMAs. It started at Dave Donaldson Black River, and that's the map there on your right. And then Next, it went to Hurricane Lake WMA, and more recently to Biomeda. But that allows us to gather enough, you know, 2+ years of data that's then used to develop the hydraulic and hydrologic models that guides this planning and restoration. Dr. Babst from UAM spoke to you recently and gave an update on the oak dormancy research. I won't rehash that other than to say that we are collaborating, as he mentioned, with the Missouri Department of Conservation personnel on a companion study that will allow us to determine specific factors that influence oak dormancy that will help guide our future water management plans. And so I've already mentioned that as we look forward and the plans that Luke and Rob will present next month will be focused on larger structures, a complete redesign of our levees, more gradual slopes, shorter levees that allowing water to overtop the levees sooner so that you have basically entire sections of levees serving as spillways, some removal of levees where warranted, and just to remind for those commissioners that were on board in, you know, the 2016-2017 time frame, that, you know, there will be some cases where we will be recommending that to decommission an area as a GTR, and we've done that with the South GTR at Hurricane Lake. And so that project and that design there in the South GTR is removing plugs that are barriers to drainage, and there will be no infrastructure in place to hold water within the South GTR moving forward, just because it's in that bad of a shape and will need decades to heal and to restore. As we look forward to water management plans, we will have to look at varying frequency and duration and depth of flooding as we move forward. That November 15th target date of closing structures is simply a band-aid of what we could do right now until we have better information. As far as where we stand currently, our engineering and design work is all but complete at BioDeview and at least the south portion of Henry Gray Hurricane Lake. That's a multi-phased area there. We are mostly complete with topographical surveys at Shirey Bay Rainy Break WMA and are nearing a point that we can begin to start talking infrastructure designs there and modeling needs. Dave Donaldson Black River has been progressing well. We've had some preliminary meetings to review some of the model runs, and that photo in the low right-hand corner there is a snapshot of a model run showing water conditions on the Winchester GTR following a flood event, and then being able to look at how the water leaves that area and how long it takes given our current infrastructure. So we are working to provide them feedback, our contractors feedback, on what we would consider the optimal run that we would ask them to do, and hopeful by this fall that they can begin the engineering and design phase for Dave Donaldson with an optimistic target date of beginning construction on the ground in 2023. We have spent, and I'll say, you know, we've spent almost $1 million at Dave Donaldson in gathering hydrology data, modeling, survey data, the LIDAR is included in that, and preparing to get to the design and construction phase. I will say that, you know, this process may seem slow and long and drawn out to some, but we realize how critically important it is that we get this right as we move forward. Biomeda, we've had multiple conversations and tours and site visits there. We have initiated the topographic surveying of all the levees and infrastructure there. with plans of following that same process of the H&H modeling as we have at Dave Donaldson. As you know, we're working there with Dr. Mickey Heitmeyer and Tom Fotai to help guide us and help guide the recommendations. There are direct links with that WMA and the Biomeda Irrigation Project, and so there has to be close coordination. Dr. Heitmeyer was heavily involved in the initial planning for that irrigation project, and so their involvement in our evaluations and recommendations is essential. I believe Commissioner Neely mentioned yesterday the work, the mulching work that has been accomplished within the south portion of Hurricane Lake, and you'll see the map shows the almost 9 miles of drainages that were mulched in 2019. I indicated that we had funding in last year's budget, but we were not able to work a single day in that area last summer. And we're hopeful that maybe by September or October of this year, we may be able to. We've done similar mulching at Biomeda and at Black River. I will say Black River, we've still not completed it. Likewise, we had funding there, and not a single day were we able to work last year at Dave Donaldson Black River with mulching. Meanwhile, as these areas flood multiple times each spring, each summer, with each flood event, there's an influx of beavers into those areas, and we have to stay on top of that. We've expanded our contracting across the state, and within our Wildlife Division base budget, we are now spending $750,000 annually for contractors. The beaver trapping is a small part of it. It's drainage maintenance, keeping water flowing through these areas while we're doing working on plans and permitting and design and all of that. Our GIS staff have been a tremendous help again in providing this dashboard that allows our staff to track daily, our contractors daily log their activities into this dashboard, and our regional staff are able to track and know where any problem areas might occur, or just to visually see where our contractors are working. Again, a huge thanks to our GIS staff. So just to kind of put this into scale and perspective, we've mentioned the 50,000 acres, and I will say our focus and most of our discussions have been on our green tree reservoirs. However, we have forest health concerns, serious concerns within our bottom and hardwood forest as a whole, not just within our green tree reservoirs. And we have significant forest health issues and rivaling what we're seeing at Hurricane Lake at areas like Burl Anthony, Lower Ouachita, that are not associated with any infrastructure on the WMA. So our current forest health assessments will be across the entire 200,000 acres of our bottom and hardwood forest. But just speaking of GTRs, Rob, Willie, and our habitat program staff last year did their best assessment of forest value out there based on most recent inventories that we have. And some of this is based off of 2014 forest health data, some where we have updated 2019 and more recent data. But best case, an absolute minimum of timber loss value since 2014 is $18 million from within our GTRs. And that's that. I hesitate to even say that because that's low. That's an old number. And we know that we've lost more trees just this summer since, you know, last year. So, but the greater value of this habitat is its significance to the wildlife resources of the state and the local economies, and that forest product value is, I won't say insignificant, but it's the least important factor of all of this. you look at restoration costs for the thousands of acres that we have impacted, and you're looking at a minimum of $500 an acre when you start looking at site prep work and herbicide and acorn collection and planting, and it's a large figure quickly. Just from a property value standpoint, you know, similar private land parcels, recreational values, you know, are somewhere in the ballpark of up to $10,000 an acre. And it's becoming apparent, we initially started with restoration infrastructure cost estimates that were in the $35 to $40 million range. Last year, as we began to get some more firm plans, we estimated $60 million, and now as we're starting to get bids on some of this work and to get you know, better information, we're likely to be more in the $100 million range of what we're looking at. However, I want to end on a positive note, that through this process, there has been a key part of this as we move forward, and part of what Rob will talk about, is that there, in addition to the infrastructure changes, there will have to be an aggressive forest management component to this. That means cutting trees, that means killing trees, undesirable trees with herbicide. I mean, it will have to be aggressive. And as you know, that oftentimes raises concerns from the public any time that we start, because it doesn't make sense to say that we have forest health concerns and then we go out and we kill some more to try to regenerate the next forest. But what we have seen at Dagmar, WMA, specifically the Mud Slough GTR, should give us hope that restoration can be achieved. What we have seen there within that GTR, I apologize for the slightly blurry photos. I literally just added that this morning. But we had a timber harvest there within a GTR. It drug out over multiple years due to flooding. 257-acre sale. Our response, we saw an immediate response in red oak seedlings that our staff documented. We included in some of our communication pieces. We made the decision for the past three waterfowl seasons now that in order to protect that regeneration and not hold water over it during duck season, that we have not closed the water control structures within that GTR. And follow-up investigations by our habitat staff has shown that that has worked, and that the red oak seedlings have now advanced. They've 79% of them, of the flagged seedlings, survived through that those flood events. It pulses up, it falls down, pulses up again, and we now have, you know, over 800 red oak seedlings established within that timber sale area of that GTR. That is the model that we hope to replicate over our 50,000 acres. So I wanted to leave you with that bit of positive, because success is, it can be achieved. So that's our bright spot in this. So I've drug out for an incredibly long time, but I'll entertain any questions that you'll have. But Luke and Rob will be back before you next month. But I wanted to set this stage for their presentation next month.
Excellent presentation, Brad. And you know, Keith, Steve, I know we post a reminder on website. The public has an opportunity to go back on YouTube and view the commission meeting. They're not always that interested in watching us work process for hours. But I think a special note for this presentation, the public would really gain an opportunity to get a chance to hear that. So really excellent, Brad. Commissioner Jones, I know you spoke yesterday. As we also had an update from Rob Willie and so forth. But any questions or comments?
Brad, I would just say that, you know, with great respect for you and for Garrick and Rob and Luke and what y'all do, I don't think there's a person in the state of Arkansas that has a better handle on this or knows more about it than you do and y'all do. And, you know, we are all a team and we want to do the right thing. I mean, just a couple of things. A smoker, you can someone smoke all their life and they start coughing, spitting up blood. They go to the hospital and doctor says, you've got lung cancer. And he'll say, well, I'm going to quit smoking. It's too late. We don't want to be too late on this. We have a problem. We may be too late to some degree, but we can't kick the can down the road anymore. And, you know, yeah, we could just for the next 5 or 6 years do nothing and then somebody else do this, but we have a responsibility and an accountability. All of us do. We're a team and we want to do the right things. And I'm glad that y'all are looking at this, and we may have some hard decisions that we members, Donaldson and Bio-DeVue and Biomeda and all of these that we flood up. If you don't flood them up and you go 2 or 3 years or 4 without flooding them up, we have a flyway problem. Ducks very much imprint. Every year, ducks and geese imprint. So to one side of it, we do that and we're devastated. To the other side, if we don't do anything, we're going to be devastated. Somewhere we've got to find something workable that saves the health of our timber, that for the next 50 years people can have big timber hunting, and we don't want to lose our flyway either. So we really have to be conscientious of hunters, of our timber, and the things that we're doing here. It's right. Very important. And you know, we do have a lot of trust in y'all and what you're doing. And, you know, Tom and Mickey are experts, no doubt. We need to, as Bobby always says, the science, we need to look at the science and what it tells us. But we have to be willing to lay these cards on the table and let's make hard decisions, good decisions, but they may be hard decisions.
Yeah. And Stan, I'll say, and just to publicly say here, I tried to express yesterday, too, that I certainly personally appreciate the comments and the kind words and the vote of confidence, you know, and certainly point all of that deservingly back to our staff. But just wanted to publicly say that we as a staff incredibly value the support of the commission through this process. I mean, this started in 2016 when we came to the commission. That was kind of the first step is, okay, we lay what we know on the table and say openly and candidly that as we move forward, some of this will not be popular, but you know, we have to make sure that we have support and we're unified as we advance, and we have been, and that's important to continue. I will say it's important in the messaging as we communicate with our users, in particular our duck hunters moving forward, that there is this mindset of, well, when is this particular WMA, when is it going to be a dry year for it? We have to keep telling ourselves that's we shouldn't look at it from that perspective. In almost every single case, we physically cannot keep these places dry. They will flood at some point through the year naturally. And so even the photos there at Dagmar, we've not closed a water control structure there for 3 years, but yet there has been waterfowl hunting opportunity every duck season. It's not at a static level for the entire season, and it may not be flooded come opening day, and it pulses up and falls out, and the seedlings have survived. So that's the reality of what we're looking forward at all of these places, that you know, we shouldn't talk about dry years. It should be more about, you know, what will be the natural years of when it would flood and how deep and for how long.
Brad, I think y'all are on the right track with, as we look forward in trying to emulate natural systems, how to get the water off is, and those structures that we put in that will quickly get water off will be key. Mm-hmm. Because it's not just, you know, if we flood late and we pull the plug, you know, the hour after duck season, it's those rains that we have in May and in June that really hurt us.
Yeah.
And so if we've got newer structures, you know, from the 60-year-old stuff, now we're coming forward with much better designs with the LIDAR planning. Y'all can apply good data. You've done great research on the best designs. And as we start to put these things in, how fast can water get out of there is going to be key for, you know, reproduction surviving and trees being healthy.
A perfect example is that the most recent tour at Biomeda, you know, woods were flooded. That was, I forget the date, it was in June, late June. But that particular large rain event, you know, on smaller scale properties with better, you know, infrastructure, that rain and subsequent flood event probably only lasted a few days. But on Biomeda WMA, the water was in the woods for a month. And so it, to your point, we have to redesign our infrastructure so that we are able to evacuate and allow that flow to maximize that, especially during the summer months.
Okay, any other comments or questions from commissioners? Brad, really
thank you all.
Outstanding. It did take some time, but it is certainly warranted and right. worthy.
Thank
really,
you.
Really great update. Okay, Director Booth, whether it's your recognition in a magazine or whatever, we are excited about today beginning. But I don't know if we set you up with something great to follow or whatever, but it's time we'll get a chance now to hear from you for your report. So.
No, thank you, Mr. Chairman. I thought in the brief time that I had with Director Pat Fitz, one of the finest things that I heard about him was that he always used his director's update to highlight what the staff was doing. And I thought that was a tremendous tribute to Pat's character and how much he cared about this agency. In that vein, I took the reins from Pat on July 1st. And since July 1st, I've met about 112 of our 653 employees. And I can't say that I'm surprised, but I am impressed by the caliber of people that we have here. I've been out with them in the field and will continue to be in the field with them. And it doesn't matter whether it's our enforcement division that wakes up every day not knowing what the day is going to bring, but puts themselves in harm's way regardless, or our resource division with the fisheries folks and the wildlife management folks who look towards the resource that we have in the state as a national treasure to be shepherded and safeguarded. Our research division that looks not for only what we currently know, but looks for uncertainty and areas to lean into to improve our decision-making process, or our educators that look to little boys and girls in the communities around them and come alongside them to educate them about nature, or even our support division that is the oil in the gears for a rich and world-renowned organization with a 106-year history. All of these people are focused and dedicated, and I have been not surprised because I've grown up with a long and deep esteem for the Arkansas Game and Fish Commission, but I am deeply impressed nonetheless. In that vein, I also want to follow up with the commissioners about what the next few weeks look like for me. I've been trying very deliberately to balance my time internal to the agency here in Little Rock to understand the normal business processes as they are, and also try to get out on the road in the field to see where the real work that this agency does is actually done. Looking forward to the next few weeks, I will try to spend a preponderance of my time on the road. And as I come to your part of the state, I look forward to meeting with you and coming alongside you as I get out in the field with our agency staff and with our influencers. So you'll be hearing more from me about dates that work for y'all for us to do this. Lastly, I wanted to follow up with what y'all heard yesterday from me at our oversight hearing committee. I had the opportunity to give a very high-level overview of my goals for the near future, and those goals included infrastructure, cultivation of broad and deep public-private habitat, hunting, and fishing opportunities, and R3. Those were the three goals that I highlighted yesterday, but I want to add a fourth one today and then provide some more detail on those four goals. The fourth goal is what I call user-focused data and digital integration. And that'll be my fourth priority. These are not in priority order, although they are priorities. So the first is infrastructure. As you know better than I do, this agency has focused a great deal on infrastructure. It is vitally important, just like we heard from Brad, on GTRs, but even beyond that. It undergirds nearly every goal we have in this agency, whether it's conserving a resource or providing access to Arkansans. But what makes infrastructure modernization and maintenance challenging is not just the finite nature of our funding, it's the length of time that projects take, the number of projects that we have, and the multiple divisions of this agency that touch a single infrastructure project. These variables all compound their individual complexity. For our infrastructure modernization and maintenance to be successful, our approach must be integrated throughout the agency. To this end, I have established a goal to create and implement throughout our agency a master infrastructure plan. This master infrastructure plan will pull together in a comprehensive visual way across the entire agency, all the divisions, and how they influence infrastructure projects, to include permitting, funding, communications with the public, all laid out over an anticipated timeline of each project. Then we're going to take all of those lines and we're going to prioritize them based on impact to our mission, impact to Arkansans, and we're going to integrate that with when one project can start, when it can end, and then when we can pick the next one up again. This integration over time will reveal what we can feasibly execute, what divisions should be doing what and when, and the primary objective of this master infrastructure plan is internal accountability and efficient execution. Those two things minimize the impact to Arkansans. So how will we undertake this task? The deputies and their divisions are already hard at work in developing this master infrastructure plan. I directed them to evaluate all of our infrastructure needs agency-wise and evaluate them for which of these projects meet the statutory criteria for the American Rescue Plan Act funding. These projects, these ARPA-eligible projects, will populate the master infrastructure plan first in preparation for submission of an ARPA funding request to the ARPA Steering Committee in August. Once we make that submission, it is my expectation that once we have as a baseline those ARPA projects included in the master infrastructure plan, that we will gradually over the next few months add all of our infrastructure projects agency-wide. The most important aspect of this master infrastructure plan is that it will be regularly updated. As circumstances change throughout our state, be it funding, be it natural disasters, be it weather, be it impact to Arkansans, construction delays, any variable that impacts either the importance or the timeline of any one of these projects, we're going to update the plan on a regular basis so we know where we're staying and we know what we need to be doing. This will be a living document. The second priority is cultivation of public and private habitat. As you've heard me state before, I believe that one of our highest obligations to Arkansans is to create public hunting and fishing opportunities. And one of the best ways that we can utilize the raw talent and reputation that this agency has earned over 106 years is by providing feedback, advice, accessibility, and guidance to private landowners and leaseholders. Again, these efforts, from my brief observation, are prone to being stovepiped in different divisions, in different regional offices, rather than integrated in a way that reflects the reality of all the important efforts and moving parts of habitat development. So next week, I will begin to meet with all of our program coordinators to ascertain not only the health of their respective resources, but what variables prevent them from improving it, from what the commissioners can do to better allow them to succeed and what resources and climate they need to succeed. It is my intent to develop an objective, collaborative scoring method of each of these resources and our wildlife management areas that will allow us a continuous means to track our performance of these resources and on our wildlife management areas, identify our shortfalls and our challenges, whether we can control them or not, and identify our areas for growth. The third priority is R3. Meaningful R3 efforts are a mandate for this agency. I have said from day one that the development of our R3 strategy is a solid first step in the effort to grow a larger tent of Arkansas outdoorsmen. But the critical element is how we implement it. I've loved getting to know Tabby and her work with Chris and their entire R3 team, and we are headed in a good direction. I was struck at the Springdale Nature Center when we were there a few weeks ago. We were right outside the archery range, and we saw two moms with four young girls with them, and the oldest two of the four girls were carrying archery cases. And on the archery cases, they had all the stickers that you would expect a teenage girl to have. I'm not sure what they were, but it kind of fit the mold. But there was one sticker that really stood out to me. It was an Arkansas Game and Fish Commission sticker. There is so much potential to bring new outdoorsmen, unlikely outdoorsmen, into what we have. And that's why I think R3 is so important for us, because it will be hard, but there is so much potential there. For R3 to be successful, it has to be meaningful and deliberate, and I have full confidence in Tabby and Chris Cole Clasier that we are going to lead the nation in our R3 efforts. We have wonderful cities and towns in this state that are thriving, that are in love with the outdoors, and as we move forward with R3, we need to come alongside as partners with those communities that know who's hunting, that know who's fishing and who's not and why. It's got to be done in tandem with these existing outdoorsmen, with moms, dads, churches, coaches that already have well-deserved respect and credibility within their communities. R3 must be grown from the bottom up, not from the top down. The last priority is digital engagement and data integration. It requires no explanation for me that when it comes to how we interact with Arkansans and our broader customers, we live in an age of blended mediums and content. We have users that preserve mail. They prefer mail. Some prefer text, some prefer emails, some prefer hard copy licenses, some prefer to get it on their phones. Some use Facebook, some use Twitter, some use Instagram, TikTok, we can go on and on. Some prefer all of it, some prefer none of it. And this makes reaching our customers, our constituents, how they want to be reached, just incredibly difficult. So moving forward, I'm committed to integrating how we act with our customers on a daily basis and how we use data in this agency. We have separate vendors for licensing, for our website, for our app, for hunters education. So it should not come as a surprise to us when it is perceived by the people that we depend on that these interactions are less than enjoyable and sometimes even unhelpful. So where do we go from here? Improving the vendor experience in license sales in the very short term is at the top of my priority list. Our website redesign will go out for industry proposals next month. And 3 weeks ago, I asked Keith Stevens to revisit a comprehensive communication strategy that included audience mapping tied to current efforts. And I emphasized for him and for Chris both that this is the opportunity for our communications division to reevaluate their structure, manning, and to identify the things that we are not doing that we should be doing, and the things that we are doing that we should not be doing. That concludes my director's update. I am excited for what the future holds, and I could not be more confident in the staff that I have behind me.
All right, Director Booth, this is a good start. I don't know if you caught it. I did when you were talking about R3 and really everything around the staff, but I caught that big smile on Tabby's face when you said we're headed in the right direction. So I know the staff's really encouraged by, you know, everything that you're laying out. And I'd say for all of us commissioners, I'm sure I'm speaking for all of us, that hearing so quickly how you and the leadership are coming together and gelling and picking up on the momentum that this agency's had and picking that and now taking it to a new level, that excites us all. So that's a great report, and that is a boatload for sure. Okay, we'll move quickly now to committee reports from yesterday, and I'll call on the committee chairs to give their reports. And Commissioner Stan Jones, chairing our Regulations Committee, we'll start with you, sir.
Thank you, Chairman. Our meeting was called to order. We had several items to discuss. Only one discussion item and three action items. Our discussion item, Brad Carner and Rob Wiley updated the commission on the recent efforts by the Wildlife Division staff over the past several months, resulting in the unsuccessful certification of game and fish on forest through the Sustainable Forest Initiative Program. In action items, we had three. The first one was Ben Batten requested approval of the proposed regulation change to correct asterisk placement in the live fish trade regulations, changes to the sport fish regulation on Lake Poinsett for the remainder of 2021 with an adjusted beginning January the 1st, 2022. The committee unanimously gave the item a due pass.
All right, thank you. Commissioner Jones, Vice Chairman Westfall, Chair of the Budget Committee.
Well, wait a minute, there's two other discussion items.
Okay.
Okay.
Sorry.
I mean, two other action items.
Don't give me a pause.
Yeah. Well, Brad Carner presented a second reading of adjustments which must be made to align the Arkansas Game and Fish Code of Regulations with the federal migratory bird framework due to the calendar creep. Proposed changes also include recent official name changes for common snipe and common moorhen to comply with federal species name changes.
Okay, is that it?
No.
Okay.
I thought you were going to ask me if you got a unanimous or a due pass.
We do that in a minute when we bring those items
all
before
right, well
us for
we,
vote. Yeah.
The committee did. So John Marks, our third item, John Marks presented a first reading involving changes to the lifetime licenses. There was just a little bit of new business. Commissioner Jones asked that Wildlife Division staff present restoration plans for Henry Gray Hurricane Lake WMA at a future meeting. There was no old business, and the meeting was adjourned.
All right. Thank you, Chairman Jones. And we will come back after all the committee reports, and we've got six items that staff will bring forward, so we'll do those then. All right, Vice Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We had one discussion item. Jamie Fisher presented the agency financial status report, and Spencer Griffin then joined Jamie to give a license sales update. We had one action item. Chris Racy presented a minute order requesting a budget increase in the amount of $5.73 million to the FY22 capital construction project budget. And this increase will help fund six projects. The committee gave a unanimous due pass, and there were no new business and no old business. Thank you, Chairman.
All right, thank you. All right, Chairman, our Commissioner J.D. Neely, Chair of Property Management.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Property Management met. We had one discussion item. Kevin Mullen updated the committee on the resolution process of an encroachment issue on Tri-Lake County and Calhoun County. We had three action items. First, Jamie Fisher presented us a routine inventory removal request. Original cost of $69,653.19 and a present net book value of zero. The committee gave the item a unanimous due pass. Our second closure, minute order, pleasure, minute order seeking the approval to allow AGFC director to enter into a six-month short-term cooperative agreement with the University of Arkansas Department of Ag for the purpose of cooperative conservation, management, and the use of the university's Pine Tree Research Station property in St. Francis County for the respective mission and public use. The committee gave this item a unanimous due pass. In our third action item, Chris Racy presented us a minute order seeking a budget increase of $5.73 million to support six capital construction projects. The committee gave this item a unanimous due pass. There was no new business, no old business. We were adjourned.
All right. Thank you, Commissioner Neely. And now we'll go to education and GIS IT, Commissioner Finley.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We had one discussion item. Kendra Engel gave a presentation about the Pradco Janet Huckabee Arkansas River Valley Nature Center fishing event that was collaborated with on Saturday, June the 12th, during the free fishing weekend. Pradco stocked brim at their expense into our lake for the event and gave away 1,500 fishing-related items, provided a free lunch for those in attendance, and the event was attended by well over 2,000 people. And if I may, just for a moment, just applaud the effort of our corporate partners, and not just in Fort Smith and around the state, and continue to encourage those others for the opportunity to invest in not just conservation, but our younger generation. It goes toward our R3 efforts, and Bruce Stanton and Pradco, and those folks are certainly at one of the top of our list, as well as many others, and certainly want to give them the recognition deserved and encourage others to be a part of that as well. There were no action items, no new business, no old business, and we were adjourned.
All right, thank you. And that was a great report and example of the kind of success that's had out there. Okay, we'll move now to, we've got six items coming off the committees that we'll now, hear from staff and be brought forward for our former approvals. Six of them, and we'll start off first with Deputy Director Ben Batten. You've got the floor.
I appreciate the promotion, but I'm Chief Ben Batten.
Okay.
Good morning, Chairman, Director, Commissioners.
It sure felt good there for a minute, though, didn't it?
I appreciate the vote of confidence. I briefed you all yesterday during committee on a couple of changes to fishing regulations. The first was concerning Addendum I-1.01, our live fish trade definitions. Again, we're just simply removing a double asterisk that was inappropriately placed and adding one where one should have been. And while a small change, it makes a big difference on what pathogens farmers have to test their fish for. The second set of changes goes to Addendum N101, which is the game fish daily limits. Currently, there are no limits on game fish at Lake Poinsett, which was an appropriate regulation when we were draining the lake to prepare for renovation. However, now that we're on the backside, we're filling back up and we're getting fish in there, it's time to adjust those. So the proposed regulations are as follows. From the time of potential adoption until the end of this calendar year, we would have catch and release only on sport fish, with the exception of channel catfish. You would be allowed to keep half a daily limit. And then starting for calendar year 2022, we would have catch and release only, except for catfish would then be allowed a full limit, and sunfish we would allow half a daily limit. We would then come back to you next year during the normal regulation cycle process to move forward for 2023. So these have been through the appropriate steps to comply with both public input and comments, and staff recommends the approval of these regulations, and we look for your consideration.
All right, thank you, Ben. And I think I know the answer to this, Commissioner Jones, but for the record, formally ask, so was this approved by a regulations committee?
Yes, it was.
All right, I have a motion to approve the request. No seconds necessary. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All right, motion approved. Thank you,
Appreciate
Ben.
Appreciate it.
All right, next, Brad Carner. Have you back up.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Similar to Ben's item, last month I presented a first reading for some minor corrections and clarifications to our migratory bird season dates. Each year we must submit season selection letters to the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service for all of our migratory bird seasons. Given our two-year regulation cycle and the wording that we had in our AGFC Code of Regulations, we discovered this spring that we were off by one day in several of our migratory bird seasons. So we're here today seeking your approval of those corrections, which will impact or adjust our duck season dates, our white-fronted goose season dates, snow, blue and Ross goose season dates, Canada geese, and then the conservation order dates. But again, that gets us in line with the federal frameworks. And then also, as Commissioner Jones mentioned, we are proposing to adjust name changes within our codes that align with the recent changes for the common snipe and common moorhen.
Yes,
yes, received, do pass.
All right, again, the motion is already there. No second necessary. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All right, none opposed. Thank you, Brad.
Thank you.
Stands approved. Okay, next, John Marks. We've got you on the lifetime license.
Good morning, Commissioners, Director. As you know, there have been some concerns raised by former Arkansas residents who, while they were residents, purchased Lyme licenses from the commission and subsequently moved out of state and found themselves here in the last few years when we adopted the changes to 24.09 that restrict the number of days that non-residents can hunt on WMAs. They found that they were subject to those restrictions, and some of those folks were not happy about that. The commission tasked us with trying to change some of the codes to basically grandfather in those folks, and we're coming forward today with the first reading of what we think will accomplish that. And basically what these codes do is, and there's six codes that are affected, it allows folks that were bona fide residents at the time they purchased their lifetime license prior to September 1st, 2021, to continue to hold that license and not be subject to the WMA date restrictions, even if they have moved out of state since they purchased their lifetime license. And so the license codes that affect that have been changed. Related to that, there's a handful of codes concerning purchasing licenses and providing accurate information that we have increased the penalty from a class 3 to a class 4 in an effort to make folks understand that the scene is not going to be tolerated, to be punished. So we've increased the penalty for fraudulently trying to buy licenses from class 3 to class 4. That results in an increase in the points from 18 to 30 points and would get them a 2-year suspension based on that conviction of that violation. The other thing that's been done with these proposals is they're renaming for consistency a few of the lifetime licenses that were slightly different wording of the names, and it helps better convey which licenses are covered by this. Commissioner Tappan had raised yesterday a good point about one of the codes mentions some language about that you have to have, you can't have a temporary internet license for hunting certain species or a telephone confirmation of that. And we have looked into that, and I think the consensus from the folks that need to weigh in on that is that we can probably remove that one sentence from that code. That same sentence is in another code, and we would remove it from that too. We're still kind of chewing on that to determine whether or not we can do it in this package, which y'all will vote on next month, or whether that will be a future package. But it is a good point raised by Commissioner Tappan, and I think we can address that. If you have any questions, I'm
okay.
Happy to answer.
Again, this is first reading, so no actions required today. But this has been a lot of work, a lot of careful work, a lot of consideration gone into this, John, by everyone. Commissioner Tappan, certainly appreciate you catching that item yesterday. We want this to go well. So any questions or comments? Okay. All right. Thank you, John.
All right. We'll be back next month with it. Thank you.
All right. Okay, we'll move. Chris Racy, you've got the floor. Capital construction project increase.
Good morning, Chairman Martin, Commissioners.
No promotions right now.
Thank you. Director Booth, glad to be here this morning. I'm here seeking a budget increase of $5.73 million from the agency's Stability Enhancement Fund to work on 6 capital construction projects. And just briefly, I'd like to mention those 6 projects for those who might be watching at home. So the first project is to spend some funds to renovate the Spring River Fish Hatchery. This is our Jim Hinkle Spring River Fish Hatchery up in Mammoth Springs. It's our only trout hatchery that's owned by the agency, and this will restore that hatchery and increase our ability to feed trout, which obviously is helpful as we manage trout across the state through stocking. Second project is along the lines of what Brad Carner presented earlier in the meeting. This project is specifically to restore the south portion of Hurricane Lake Wildlife Management Area and spend those funds to help us move water on that area and restore timber health in that part of the state. I would definitely also like to mention the really strong partnership with Ducks Unlimited. Appreciate Corey being here and being a consistent participant and contributor to our agency and on these projects, specifically with GTRs and the other members of the Ducks Unlimited friend and partnership that we've worked with over a good portion of time, helping us secure NACA funding, a $1 million NACA grant that will also go along with this funding that I'm asking for today to help secure that part of the project. So we're grateful for that. Third, we have dam repair at Lake Overcup. Again, we've got some sloughing banks on the dam levee piece at Lake Overcup, so we're going to do some repairs there. Fourth, we're going to repair the roof at the Jonesboro Nature Center. That was our second nature center that we built back in 2004, so we've got some roof repairs that we need to take care of. Fifth, work on a fishing pier at Tri-County Lake in South Arkansas at Fordyce, so we're glad to work on that. And then finally, do some dam repairs to the Painway Dam structure that impounds St. Francis Lake in Northeast Arkansas, and that provides a lot of duck hunting opportunity and also some fishing opportunities as well. So a necessary repair that we'll work on with those funds. So I would be remiss if I didn't know agency staff have worked a lot to bring this forward. They've been consistent in their approach and really appreciate the work. It's been a lot of staff across most of our divisions, and again, recognizing the strong partnership and hard work of Ducks Unlimited to make all of this possible. I'm proud to be representing their hard work today and asking for $5.73 million to work on these capital construction projects over the course of the next year. This is an action item, and there's a minute order for your consideration.
All right, thank you, Chris. And it has a lot of very good work coming together and culminating finally. Okay, 2 committee approvals are required on this one. So, Vice Chairman Westfall, did your committee, budget committee, approve this yesterday?
Yes, sir. Mr. Commissioner, our committee gave this unanimous approval.
Okay, and Commissioner Neely, was this approved by property management?
Received a due pass.
All right, so again, motions applied, no second required. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
No opposed. All right, Chris, congratulations.
Thank you.
And thanks. Okay, next, Jamie Fisher, inventory removal.
Good morning. Minute order presented for your consideration. Routine removal of inventory items. Original cost $69,653. Current book value $0.
All right, again, Commissioner Neely, was this approved by property management?
It did.
All right, again, no second necessary. All in favor?
Aye.
No opposed. Thank you, Jamie.
Thank you.
All right. One more here. We've got Chris Koeklaser up. And this one's a very interesting one you've worked on a long time as well. So.
Yes, sir, Mr. Chairman. Good morning, Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, Director. What I have before you today is a minute order for your consideration for us to enter into a cooperative agreement with the University of Arkansas Division of Agriculture so that we can continue to cooperatively manage the University of Arkansas's Pine Tree Research Wildlife Demonstration Area that's very popular for our hunting and fishing public over in the east part of the state. So I ask for your consideration so that the director can enter into that agreement. It's a short-term agreement. It'll get us through the end of December. And our goal while this agreement's in place is to work on a long-term agreement and a management plan with the University of Arkansas.
Chris, just recap again the size of that and what it means to the public.
Yeah, it's 11,850 acres, and for if you look at where most of the public land is situated, most of the public land is all situated west of there. It is the most eastern extension of where the public land is. So if you're a citizen in Forest City or Wynn or some of those communities over there in St. Francis County, this is your place. This is where you go. This is your Biomeda or Henry Gray Hurricane Lake. I mean, this is it for them. And as you recall, the university at one time was considered selling it, and they have since decided to change their mind and their course. But through all of that, we have been committed to work with them, and we enjoy the relationship with all of our cooperative partners across the state on wildlife management areas, because most of our wildlife management areas are cooperatives. So, and you know, today, if you had to replace 11,000 acres, the cost to do that would be, you know, tremendous. And anytime you have a piece of public land, you ultimately want to get as many benefits from that land as you can. And they do research there. Our job is to help manage the wildlife and manage the public so that they can use it. And that's what we want to continue to do.
Good outcome there. And again, everybody's desire is that it's a win-win-win.
Yes.
Both the university's tremendous move on their part, partnering with us. The public's a big win, Director Booth, and certainly great here. Okay, Commissioner Neely, once again, looking for approval out of property management.
Received to do pass.
All right, no second necessary. All in favor, say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All right.
Thank you.
Chris, thank you very much. That really concludes all of our scheduled business. Any new business, commissioners? One thing, just real quick, because we're moving along, but I'd like each time, because the commissioners are representing their constituents all across the state in different ways, and we don't have to say something every time, but I think it is good to hear anything that's on your minds. And I'll start. Dr. Beaupre stepped out. Maybe he'll be back here in a moment, but even from Dr. Beaupre. But Commissioner Neely, Finley.
We get confused a lot.
Yeah, that's not a promotion either, by the way.
Mainly at the breakfast table. No, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Onto the Pine Tree Reservation. I've got, you know, a lot of folks over in that part of the country, and I've got to know them over the last few years. And you could fill this room with a thimble full of memories of the people that have told me stories about their grandfather being the first experience they've had. And how heartbroken they were that there may be a possibility that they may go away. And just the euphoria of the folks that see that as a long-term future for them to continue that tradition on. And so on behalf of those folks, I'd say thanks to the commission's efforts and those who've played a part in keeping that in the public's interest. And, mm-hmm. and I know that they'll continue to fill this room with memories for all the right reasons.
All right, great. I know you've had a few coffee shop conversations probably.
That I have, yeah.
Commissioner Neely, anything?
You know, everything's good in South Arkansas. We've had a tremendous fishing year. Everybody's catching fish. All the Oxbow lakes are supercharged from all the flooding, and it's been a good year. I hear lots of success. Our lakes are producing well and hearing good reports. Giant Sylvania has been nipped a little bit, I think, from the help, too, of that hard freeze over on Lake Columbia in Erling. It's certainly been better. And then, again, there's excitement on the Fordyce Tri-Lake project that will certainly help. That's a good community project. We're excited about that.
You might just make sure everybody knows what that project
sure,
is.
Sure. So that's a fishing pier. Game and Fish has been in the works on getting this built for Tri-Lake. It's a county-owned lake. Is that right? No, it's our lake. Okay. And about 300 acres, Ben, somewhere in there. And but it's a tremendous opportunity for bank fishing and, you know, small community type fishing. You don't have to have a bass boat to go fish Tri-Lake. And so this pier project will give more opportunity for handicaps and youth kids that don't have a boat. It will extend down into the lake and allow more fishing opportunity. We've got numerous businesses that are coming together to help get the material. I think it was presented yesterday that most of the materials are going to be donated by local businesses and individuals, and so we're going to thank them and have them recognized. I think it'll be a good pattern going forward for as we look at other opportunities throughout the state to open up banks, open up small reservoirs, kind of what we saw yesterday on that project up there out of Fort Smith, where 12-acre lake is easily fished by families, you know, gathering around the banks and don't have to have a boat. So it's a great project, and it's well received. So lots of good stuff going on. Of course, record deer harvest last year, and I expect another good one this year.
I know you're trying to promote a gun range in that part of the state as well. So there's a lot.
We've got a meeting. We've got just got through the completion over in Warren, that project, with the rifle range, or about to. And then we've got SAU Magnolia. We're going to be meeting with them and looking at opportunities for us to work with SAU. Excuse me, Chancellor Trey Berry has reached out to our staff, and we're planning a trip down there in next month now with scheduling. Well, we're going to do it this week.
September 7th.
So we're looking forward to that, and in ways that we can expand not only just the gun range opportunity there, but they've got a 700-acre parcel as part of that campus that we can partner with them, we hope, and help do teaching opportunities for hunting and R3 efforts and things like that. So lots of great potential there.
Well, thank that you do have a lot in your area, and JD, I mean, everybody knows and recognizes. You're a lot like Anne Marie when I think about it. I don't know very many things that she misses attending, and you're much the same, save Stan and others, but you've got a lot that you're helping influence there.
Some people are retired.
Okay.
Others have to work.
Okay. All right. Well, Vice Chairman Westfall, you want to go now or you want
sure.
to end? Okay.
Yeah, that's great. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I was really proud of what Kendra and Tabby did at Wells Lake there in Fort Smith. They had over 2,000 kids and families come to fish that on a free fish day, and we saw that yesterday, and lots of pretty smiles on a lot of kids' faces. And we're blessed in the Fort Smith area, where we've got a 70,000-acre Fort Chaffee. And then the city was really blessed when they handed back to Fort Smith and Barling 7,000 acres, which Wells Lake is part of that. And the Nature Center there in Wells Lake take in about 170 acres. And then on Fort Chaffee, we have an excellent quail population. And then Ben Guerin, which adjoins Chaffee, it's, I can't remember, 1,000-plus acres. But all along the Ben Guerin golf course there, they have the Game and Fish has worked to put back in native grass and a lot of pollinators, plants there, and you can, as you play golf there, you can hear quail out there in the grass. So they're coming back. So there's some good things happening in our area. The Frog Bayou, there's going to be an expansion of that wet soil, moist soil there. And so there's a lot of good things happening in our neck of the woods.
Thank you, Vice Chairman Westfall. Benny was sharing with me yesterday, or day before yesterday, reminding me it's been 30 years since there's been a commissioner.
Perry Michaels, I think, was the last one. He was appointed by Bill Clinton.
Yeah, and so, you know, I think, again, the reason why I think this is occasionally worth doing and hearing is a lot of people sometimes miss how much it means to have the Olympians in these areas and so forth. Commissioners get a chance to engage and so forth. So these are good reports, good updates. Benny's holding back. I've had a little chance to hear some of the things he hopes to really make happen this year. So I know there's more good news to come.
More good news to come.
All right. Commissioner Jones.
Just looking forward to Tuesday. And, you know, Garrick and Brad, you know, when we was over there and Chris Racy at the last meeting, there was a lot of questions. And, you know, I know that y'all, there'll be some questions this Tuesday about, you know, we're ready to go, and y'all kind of will probably have to give some kind of a little update, but looking forward to that, and also for the people that's going to visit to get to see how Black River Donelson is different than the other ones, and which they are all different, but it'll be very educational and informative for us to go over there and look and see this and make be able to make better decisions, you know, for what we got to do.
All right, thank you. Commissioner DeRamus, anything?
Chairman Martin, I always like an opportunity to tout our fisheries department. I think it's important for people to know that over the past fiscal year, we have stocked over 2 million Florida largemouth bass throughout the state of Arkansas, along with, I believe it's 500,000 of the northern largemouth bass as well. And recently, half a million striped bass over at, Lake Ouachita, Ben?
Ouachita, Norfolk, and Beaver.
Right, so quite a variety going on there. And then something that's happening in my own backyard is recently a friend of mine from the who's on the board of the First Tee here in Little Rock reached out and asked if Game and Fish could get involved with any of their youth programs. And I set her up with Tabby in the education department because one thing you think about with golf courses, there's normally a pretty good fishing pond on there too. So that is another way that our people are bridging the gap and getting in to these youth activities to encourage them to get outdoors, not only to play golf, but also teaching them how to fish. So I hope that's a program that takes off and spreads around the state and maybe even nationwide with the First Tee. I think that's a really big deal, and I think it's a cool program that could be happening here in the future.
All right, great update. All right, look, I think between Commissioner Neely and DeRamus both touting how fantastic fisheries is, Ben, that's the promotion today. That's it. That's all you're going to get, though. All right, Commissioner Tappan, again, we already expressed our welcome, and you don't take long to warm up and get going. Your contributions already hit the pavement yesterday, but any comments?
Mr. Chairman, thank you for having me. I don't have many items as I'm 22 days new, but I do have an abundance of appreciation. I first want to say to this body, all of you all attending the governor's appointment and Director Booth and staff, I appreciate you. You've been so equally as helpful introducing me to the agency. Director Booth went even further, organized a orientation for me, and our chief deputies, Carl Clasier and Racy, welcomed me last Thursday. They brought in Ben and Brad and Major Jake Dunn, Tabby. Landon organized it all, so I am so appreciative of just how well I've been welcomed and brought up to speed. I'll try to have a more substantive report next time.
I have no doubt, but again, real excited to have you. Okay, there you are. Okay, Dr. Beaupre, we just spend a little bit of time just quickly, not anything prepared, and you can pass, but just going around from the commissioners, their respective areas and so forth, just any comments. The research division in particular, and with your support coming out of the university, there's so many things that come up. JD was even talking again about the Salvinia issue with all kinds of invasive species problems, whether it's whatever it is. But any comment from you from your role in research and help for us?
First, sorry about stepping out. I'm excited, really excited about the deer research project. I think that's going to get us some really valuable information that we, number one, don't have, and number two, we'll know it's specific to our deer populations here in Arkansas. I think that's an extremely exciting project, and they're meeting with great success at this point in terms of getting animals tagged and tracking them. So I look forward to continued results in that arena. The number of challenges that we face that are biological or physical in terms of moving water, I mean, I listened to, you know, Brad's presentation, and I'm thinking, how can I help with this? And the answer is that, you know, this is an engineering problem. We all know that we've got to get the water off the trees. And we all know that we've got to recondition those forests, regenerate them in a way that provides food for the wildlife that we're interested in supporting. We know how to do that. What we don't seem to know how to do is to get rid of the water. And I mean, we know how to do it, but it's difficult, and especially difficult because there are conflicting or confounding factors, including having water available for agriculture, and also making sure that there's capacity, at least, to take it, to absorb and deal with the changes in rainfall that we're coping with over the last few years. And this is a significant problem. Now, I'd much prefer that problem to the problem they're having in the West with the severe droughts. I think that we can expect the kinds of rain patterns that we're experiencing to continue. The patterns of drought in the West are continuing, and they're effectively pushing some of that moisture to the East. And the projections I'm seeing on that suggest that there's no break in sight for them. So water management is going to become a bigger and bigger problem of wildlife management in the state as we go forward. Invasives, holy cow, we have invasives, and we need to figure out how to deal with them. And whether it's snakehead fish or salvinia, any number of other issues, I think we need to aggressively manage those as well as we can. Some of them, the pythons in Florida is a great example of how you can create an invasive problem and not be able to back out of it. And that the problem with the pythons is that they're semi-aquatic. They disappear into large swamps like the Everglades. You cannot root them out. You can't hunt them out. There's not a large group of people that can go out and harvest them and eat them because they're full of mercury, folks. So you can't eat them. That is a problem that I hope doesn't expand into our neck of the woods, but I could see how it could eventually make its way up to the Mississippi drainage, and then we would have them. There aren't answers to some of these invasives. Zebra mussels, there's no good answer other than mechanical removal and cleaning. So biologically, we're standing here going, I don't know how to fix this. This is not a fixable problem. I don't want to be negative because I think that there are some issues that we can address, that we can fix. And we have to determine, and I guess to some extent, I think about it in terms of how do we contain these issues, keep them from spreading, keep them from becoming horrible situations for us, so that when somebody does come up with a strategy that actually works to contain or remove these things, that the problem is not statewide, it's focused in a smaller space. That'll make it more easier for the generations to come to maybe be able to solve that. So we're talking about, you know, Asian carp. We've done a great thing, I think, trying to limit the movement of those hard to identify minnows from bait use from one waterway to another. I think that's a great positive step towards maintaining the integrity of that waterway down the line. So I think you know, we have a very capable staff. A research staff is excellent, and we have people that are very knowledgeable about these invasives, and we have to turn to them to do the hard work of trying to figure out what the best steps are to deal with them. And we need to also have some radar out for burgeoning problems that don't, so they don't sneak up on us and suddenly become unmanageable. So I think this is an ongoing thing. It's an evolving set of problems that we have to keep our eyes on and do the best we can to manage.
Great report. And what a great reminder for us, Dr. Beaupre, how important your role is in support of staff. No, quite seriously.
Thank you.
I mean, all of us, you know, many times you're right here with us all the time. and the things that I know our staff draws on and uses your support is often unseen by us. But that was a great report, and again, a great reminder of the value that you bring. So thank you for that. Okay, that's really, again, all of our business. There's no old business, but Commissioner DeRamus, just to confirm with you, no need for executive session.
No need for executive session.
Okay. Before before I adjourn us, I think I'll just give this encouragement from all of us. Just to not take for granted that we are back in this room together. We're not on WebEx or Zoom or anything else, but just an encouragement to continue to stay safe, encourage everybody you know, you can, you love, whatever, to get vaccinated, and let's not lose what we're enjoying here. So be safe. Have a great remainder of the week and good weekend. And again, Director Booth, congratulations and a great start and a great focus of challenges going forward. So we'll stand adjourned.